Okay, we got hand tools, we got power tools, we got CNC machines, but apparently that's not enough. Now us woodworkers need to learn about lasers also. This is the NEJE Master 2S Plus with a 30 watt laser. I know nothing about lasers yet. We'll see how hard this is to learn. We got an unboxing, and over the next couple of days, I will try it out and we'll take you along. So first, the standard disclaimer. No, I'm not being paid to make the video, but yes, NEJE did send me the laser for free, but also no, they don't have any editorial control over the video. They just sent it to me to try out. So this is how it comes. Yes, it's a Chinese company, but they do have a warehouse in the United States. So it came, you know, domestically. I've got the laser here, and then this is the MF6 Air Assist Kit, which comes aside. I've watched a few videos, and apparently having an air source close to the laser will help with burns. Got a little instruction manual that I'll need to review, and everything is solidly packed in foam. For a kit, it's fascinating how few parts there are. Here's everything unboxed. You have the laser. You have one part of the gantry, you have another part of the gantry. So all the wheels and the belts, the motors, they are all already mounted. Here's the USB interface. You have a set of protective glasses, you have a power cord, and then you have a little pack of tools, and yeah, there's a USB cord and some sample materials. And that's it. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 items. Again, this was the Air Assist kit, which is a separate kit, and the instructions. So 6 items, that's it. So I need to now review the manual and let's get this put together. So for step one, we take this assembly and we put it to this assembly, and the cable is notched. So it'll only go one way. They do give you a little wrench. But just go get your own 8mm, and that'll probably be much happier in your hands. And step two is to take the laser module and install it in the carriage. And this one has this little slide here, which goes in, and the manual says put it about 30mm, so that's about the right amount. And then they give you an Allen key to tighten this clamp. Then we take the cable and plug it in. And so, yeah, that's the basic machine assembled. And it, when I first saw it, I was kind of puzzled because I'm used to like a CNC where there's two rails, and this is just has the one rail. But yeah, it's not doing like routering or whatever that a CNC does. It's just moving the laser around. So I can understand it doesn't need to have quite as much support around the edges. And this is interesting to me for portability, because that way you can put it away. Down here at the one end, there's a USB port for plugging in your data cable. There's a power connector for plugging in your AC adapter, and what I'm guessing is a reset button. Tucked in behind here is the controlling board, which I'm guessing is the brains of the whole operation. They do also supply some L brackets, and they suggest that you attach this to a table because it will shake when it moves back and forth. So you probably want to get like a 2-foot by 2-foot sheet of plywood and bolt it down to that. And I'll probably do something like that and then begin testing. So it's been a couple of weeks since that last bit that I recorded, and I've been playing around with this machine on and off during that time. And the first thing that you're gonna notice is that I have not yet built a base for this unit. And okay, maybe some of that's laziness, but I also like that this is nice and light, so I could just move it to the piece if I want to, and I can put it away for storage. And I also realized that my workbench here is 2 feet wide, and that means I can just get a clamp here on either end. I do have to be careful that I don't interfere with the carriage where I put the clamp, especially at this end. The carriage goes right up to it. So I've been finding that that's good enough for my practicing. In the future, I might still make a base for it. So first thing I've learned is I hate these glasses. Now you need to use safety glasses because it's a laser. You don't want to damage your vision, but you'll notice I wear glasses, and that means these need to fit over my glasses. And I find there's reflection in between. You gotta do it, but it's annoying. So like all the other inexpensive low-end engravers on the market, there's no enclosure. That's one of the reasons why you need glasses. generally, I don't mind that because it means it's cheap, but also it's light and portable. I can move this to the workpiece, or I can move it around in my shop. I can put it away for storage. That also means there's no built-in ventilation. When I'm doing a heavy cutting session, I have this exhaust fan going in my window. And I also have a small little fan that I built that is blowing across the unit. So even with that exhaust fan and with this other fan, if I'm doing a lot of engraving, I'll start to get a haze in the room. I probably should not be doing this in a basement, but it's cold in my garage. Just bear that in mind. If you get one of these units, you're responsible for your ventilation, and yeah, you probably should use it in a well-ventilated shop. So in the past 2 weeks, I've tried out two different kinds of laser control software. First, the NEJE system comes with its own NEJE engraving software. It appears to be fairly basic software at first. You have a canvas which represents your engraving area, but what's really good for beginners is it has a tutorial section. It has here a photo gallery where it has a whole bunch of built-in stock images. And you know, these are all just basically JPEGs or pictures, that sort of thing that you can try using. But what's also interesting is it has an online G-code, and this is vector graphics. There's either line drawings. So for example, this ladybug, I pull that into the canvas and you can adjust the size of it. You really only have two controls. You have a slider which controls the laser power from all the way up to 100% down to zero, though I'm told that I think 20% is about the minimum that actually does something. And then you have another slider here, which is, they label it burning time, but that's basically how fast the gantry is going to go, and it will put a warning there if it's like you're going too fast. And yeah, I've seen some people critique this, that it's really basic, but for a beginner, that might be, yeah, just fine. So if we look over here at this board, this is where I've been doing a lot of sample burning, and I would make notes as to speeds. And you know, like here, I'm saying this is the NEJE software, and here I had the burning set way too light. And then here was one where I bumped the machine partway, so the writing didn't work out. Here, this is the NEJE software. I loaded in a picture of me, and it's not great, but it's legible. And considering that I really didn't know what I was doing, I just loaded it in and poked around at the menu items, I thought that was pretty good. Now here, for instance, is one where I had the speed too slow or the laser too high, and I just aborted it. I'm not even sure what it was going to be. Again, here, you know, from Tom and Jerry, I aborted the image because it was just burning in too deeply for what I wanted. Here's one of my more later attempts. This is one of the samples, again, from the NEJE software. Like here, like I wrote down, I was going at a 2 millisecond speed, 51% on the laser. And yeah, it produced a nice, crisp image of an airplane. Here's that ladybug I was showing you. This is on Cherry. Again, same settings, the NEJE software, 51% with 2 millisecond speed. A real nice, simple, clean engraving. So in terms of other software, I've been using Lightburn. There's another one out there called Laser GRBL, which I haven't tried yet. Lightburn is a huge, complicated package. I'm really only beginning to scratch the surface of it. So no surprise, my practices all usually involve versions of my logo. That's what I've been practicing and trying in here. Like here, this one is really burned in quite deep. It's quite nice. And again, you got to make notes as to what your settings are. Here's one on Cherry, turned out quite well. And here's some practices on plywood, and you know, that one was way too light. And then here I was showing how, making note of how here I just had to change the focus and I got a different result. Getting the focus right is really important. There's a focus knob here on the side that you can use to adjust the laser, and it'll go from a line down to a point, and you really want to get it down to a point. So let's close this out with a little show and tell. One of the things that I've been practicing over the last few years is paddle making. This is a little one that I had made for my son when he was much younger, so it's kind of our spare paddle right now. And one of the things that I did here is I engraved my logo. So this was an already finished piece. It wasn't bare wood, but the, you know, laser just went through the finish, no problem. Yeah, this is a big item, so here it's really nice that the laser doesn't have an enclosure, because I fit the paddle in, it tapers down, so I put a little wedge under it, and then I had this board clamped there to make sure this wasn't moving. And at this end,
kind of had the piece clamped, and it's a bit tricky because with a freeform object like this, it's a little bit tricky to make sure you're in a straight line so you know where it's going to do its engraving.
I'll admit I'm a little off-center, but the results turned out really well. And then later on the other side, I put my logo up here, and then I rotated it 90 degrees, and I added my name, and it's sort of a serial number here. It's a little hard to read, 2012-6.
Really happy with how it turned out, and I look forward to doing things like this with other projects. I mean, again, being a portable unit, I could either bring the project to the laser, bring the laser to the project, or, you know, maybe engrave a piece while you're constructing it so that it's smaller. So finally, I have this offcut from another project that I turned into a coaster that I keep on my desk, and I wanted to engrave a picture on it. And on the NEJE website, they talk about using Inkscape, which is a free line drawing program. I guess you could use one of the Adobe products if you want to. So I found a picture of a canoe on a lake that I wanted to engrave. And I took that picture and I converted it to grayscale, and then I imported it into Inkscape. And then I just drew on top of the image with Bezier curves. It's pretty easy to just draw a line and then push and pull it into a curve that you want. So this went fairly quickly, depending on the amount of detail that you want to put into the picture. And when it's finished, I simply delete the original photo and I'm left with all my line drawing. I can then export this as a DXF type file, which I can import into Lightburn for then engraving on the laser. The NEJE software supports this also, but it needs a specific export filter for Inkscape, which you can get on their website.
Okay, let me stop there for a moment. I was reviewing the footage, and I think I went through the explanation about Inkscape just a little bit too quickly. So over here on the left in the list of tools, you have this one tool which says draw Bezier curves and straight lines. That's this little icon here. And then up here, I have this other little icon, which is edit paths by node. Those are the only two tool things that I'm talking about. So when you click on draw Bezier curves, and then you just go point, click, everywhere you click, you're dropping a line segment. And then you double click at the end, and there's your line segment. And then you go up to this other one, the edit paths by node, and I select that tool. And then you can come down and you can select a segment of the line, and then you can just grab it and push. And you can push it into any sort of a curve that you like. If you don't like that curve, you can push it the other way. And then you see it's putting out these little helper things. You can also grab those and start twisting it around. And then you go to the next one and you select that line segment and you do the same thing. So that's all I was doing. I was drawing a line, and then I was using the edit paths tool to bend the line into a curve, you know, and then I deleted the underlying photo when I was done. And here goes our practice run. So my test run worked out. I like the positioning. And so now I just want to do the final here, and I'm just going to lay this on top. I did first have to reset the height of the laser module and then adjust its focus because this workpiece was at a different height. Over on my computer where I have the pattern, I'm going to use the frame option, which tells the laser to draw a square around where it's going to burn. This is just one last double check that everything is right in the position where I want it to be. By the way, yes, this is the actual speed of the laser when it's at work. There we go. So I didn't show it on camera there, but I actually ran that twice. I didn't touch it at all, so the piece didn't move, but I didn't really like the intensity of the initial lasering, so I slowed it down a bit in the software, and I just ran it a second time, and the results turned out great.
Okay guys, I think that's about as far as I was gonna take this one. This is just me, who's an experienced woodworker, but an absolute newbie when it comes to lasers, trying it out, getting some experience, getting some inspiration. And yeah, I certainly had that. I had a lot of fun. I got to learn some new things. There's a bit of a steep learning curve, but once you sort of start to get over the hump, you can build on it. I made some fun engravings. I haven't even scratched the surface. I haven't done any cutting. I haven't done really much with photos. That could be something that could come in future. This unit is about $259 right now, November 2021. There are cheaper units, there are more expensive units. It's really not that expensive to get into trying these things out. Links to everything that I talk about are down in the video description, and I think that's it. So we'll see you on the next one.